everyone, and welcome to Red United TV. It's your boy, Ivorian Spice, and welcome to Catch Up Volume 20. Another week, I'm also here with my boys, the usuals. Amok, what are you saying today?
I'm alright, a bit disappointed over yesterday, but another week, looking forward to the show.
And Jets, what are you saying today, bro? You good?
I'm blessed, as always. Not too happy about yesterday's game, but we move on.
Definitely, we move on. And remember, guys, if you're new to the channel, remember to subscribe, smash that like button, and remember to share to everyone that you know. Of course, guys, this week, of course, we'll be discussing the result against PSG. That's on the agenda. The result, especially against Southampton. The controversial post made by Edinson Cavani. We'll also be looking at the weekend Premier League wrap-up and also the preview against West Ham. So we go straight into the game against PSG. Manchester United won, of course. PSG 3, of course, as I said in my post, you know, Paris strikes Manchester, you know, from Paris with love, you know, like the film, you know what I mean? Like, that defeat against PSG, good points and then the bad points. The good points at times, in certain spells, as mentioned, are good at. We look good in certain spells, but majority, we had good chances. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, we had good chances. Chances that should have been scored, especially by Martial. Annoyed me in that game. You know, I'm very frustrated with him right now. I'm not happy with Martial right now because of yesterday. I felt like he had two chances where he could have buried it. But I don't know where his confidence is at. He's probably at home. His confidence probably laying at home or probably in a coffin because I don't know what's going on with him recently this season. The red card against for Fred pissed me off, of course. But again, his fault and also not his fault. Manager's fault and also the player's fault for behaving reckless. Especially knowing that you're on a yellow card. And especially knowing that you just escaped death as well. What else? Ollie's comments at the end of the match pissed me off. Because of course, Ollie as usual. He, I don't know if he's a comedian. He's a professional comedian. He's like say stuff that just makes you laugh.
I mentioned that comment yesterday.
Yeah.
I was really upset about it as well.
Is it? Comment,
yeah.
Of course.
I didn't like it.
So we're gonna start off with let's start off with Amok because he's in his feelings. I know, I can see that. Like you, what did you think of that game?
I felt like what you said, like there were times in the game that I felt like we were dominant. We were actually one of the we were doing what we were supposed to do or what we've been doing against PSG ever since. But at the end of the day, Fred getting sent off changed the whole concept of the game, which I feel like Fred should have known better. You're a player, you're professional. You escaped a definite red card. You got given yellow. Like, you could have just used your like he. I don't want to be in my feelings or anything, but as a manager, you should have used your third or fourth sense and said, "You know, I will do something." And this. Funniest thing about this was PSG made three changes, right? And you got individual playing in your team that's actually playing so good but causing you a whole lot of problems, which is Fred. Do something. One thing in the first half, I don't know if you guys noticed, our midfield did not have that much of creativity. They actually dominated the midfield in the first half. And
like three defensive players PSG had.
Like, we should have at least. I know Pogba is injured, but he still came in. So if you're going to bring in Pogba in the second half, why didn't you start Van de Beek? Like we've been saying, for the fourth week in a row, if we play United at Old Trafford and play defensive, there's 80% chance we might lose the match.
We've been saying this.
And we've been saying it every week for the fourth time in a row. It's just upsetting. I feel like there was like you said, there was a spell in the match that you felt like, no, we got this. That Mateo, I didn't want to talk about Mateo because to be honest with you, I'm one of his biggest fans. I feel like he's still one of the best players in the world. But that confidence, I don't know where he's gone though. We need to, this way you see the character of our players, the character of the managers, and the character of the team itself. I've seen other players being down and you got players talking to them. Like Jesse, for example. Well, it was a dreadful match yesterday.
And Jenks, what was your opinion of that match overall?
Do you know what? It was always going to be a tight game.
Yeah.
PSG needed the win. And now that group is definitely looking like a group of death. We need to go to Leipzig now and draw a win to go through. The game in itself, for me, I don't want to sound like a broken record, but we've been saying this. You can't start Fred and Scott together at home. It does not make sense. I don't care if we're playing PSG,
Bayern Munich,
All-Stars 11. We can't be defensive at Old Trafford. Old Trafford is no longer a theatre of dreams. It's becoming a theatre of nightmares.
True. Definitely true.
Van der Beek or Pogba had to start that game.
Game yesterday.
It was always going to be a tight game. I'm not too upset with the loss. However, I feel like Ollie again, man management, very poor. Fred should have got maybe one or two red cards in the first half. How are you not taking him off? How are you not taking him off? You could have had two or three red cards just in the first 45 minutes. So for me, Ollie, not great. Not great for the management. The team done okay, especially in the first half, but we kind of collapsed in the second half, towards the end anyway. Not happy with the result, to be honest with you, but
we had
good chances.
Good chances.
Three or four. Like, good
very,
chances.
Very, very good chances. Therefore. I think Mateo had like three. Mm-hmm. Like, there's one actually that could have been a goal, but I don't know when that confidence gone though. Mm-hmm. It was really, like you said, you're upset with him. I was really devastated with him yesterday. Because them chances. But like, it's football though. Mm-hmm. I knew we were going to lose after he missed that much. And then the ball that Bruno made this perfect. He just said, this is a gift. This is a Christmas gift. Umati Hachiji was just banging the ball in. Mm-hmm. But the defender, the keeper, I don't know where they came from. He just blocked the ball. It was like, wow. Bruno's the player though.
What about Cavani's lob?
It's beautiful.
That was sensational, right?
That was beautiful.
Sensational.
I wish you went in.
No, but by an inch.
As much as it didn't go in, they just let you know
the
quality
that
you're getting from the individual. That mm-hmm. not everyone does that. Mm-hmm. I thought he was going to go with the attacking pass the ball to Mateo, because Mateo was a little bit above of him. Mm-hmm. But they think the ball chipped that ball. That was brilliant. Mm-hmm.
Cool. Let's talk about Fred. Fred, especially that red card. And was Oli at fault, Jax?
1,000,000%. You know when Fred headbutted... Who did he headbutt?
Fred headbutted someone, but go away with it. You know, I've never seen that in my life. That get headbutting... He did headbutt him. I know the player made a meal out of it.
Yes.
But at the same time, I saw the player leaning first.
Do you know what it is?
Yeah.
That was worse than, remember Martial at Tottenham when he got sent off?
Yeah, that was
worse than that.
Yeah, definitely.
In the Premier League, that's 1,000,000% a red card. Definitely. But for some reason, passed off Fred, got let off.
God blessed him.
God blessed him, mm-hmm. but not for too long, you know? And it's a case of, in the first half, it is down to the gaffer to say, listen, A, we're at home, we've got two defensive players, let's switch it up. Two, or B, should I say, Fred's on a tightrope. He had to come off. Van der Beek was there. Pogba was there. He had to come off. But that in itself isn't an excuse for the loss. But I still feel like if Solskjaer was more on point, we may have won that game or maybe even drawn.
Namur, what do you think? Who was that for out there? Was it the player or was it the manager?
If I was to give percentage to it, I would say only definitely get like 70%. I would give 30% to Fred.
70, 80. Mm.
The reason why I say because you're professional, like I said before, you're getting paid weekly. You're getting, you lot professional. This is something that you brave. Mm-hmm. There should be a level of what they do. Because we've seen a lot of bullshit these players go through and some of them get away with it. But he was so lucky to get away with that, you know, that headbutting yesterday. Mm-hmm. Definite record.
1,000,000.
And so I could blame him for that, but at the end of the day, the game had tension. Both team wanted to win. I have nothing against Fred. I feel like he was desperate. He wanted to win. He wanted to give his life up for the club. Like, you see him in every tackle. I understand that. But that's why we got the fourth and fifth eyes, which is the managers and the assistant managers.
Of course.
He should see all of this mm-hmm. and rectify the problems that they see. Because I don't think Fred knew what he was doing. There was some time in the first half, Bruno actually went up to Fred and said, like, calm down. Mm-hmm. After he stepped on the guy's foot, when he got away with it. Like, at the end of the day, I think Ollie definitely got 70% blame on this one. because you're the manager. You're the one that chooses when to make your substitution, or who to come out or who to come in. So at the end of the day, you should have known that Fred, but I can't blame Oli. As much as I don't want to say this, but I can't blame Oli though. Because Oli is this guy that likes playing defensive football at Old Trafford.
Mm-hmm.
He loves to see Fred and Mayonnaise or whatever playing defensive football.
Cool. My opinion,
mm-hmm.
definitely Oli is to blame, has to take some part to blame, because at the end of the day, like I said before, his daughter knew that Fred needed to get sent off, but he needed to come off at half time. Like everyone can see that Fred needed to be come off at half time. His daughter knew it, probably my late grandmother knew it, that he needed to come off. Like anyone that doesn't even know football knew that. This guy is on high blood pressure right now. He needs to come off. Two incidents in that first half that warranted a red card, and he escaped with it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it is, and then partially that's what the players thought, knowing that you're on a yellow card, knowing the level of the match that we are, what's at stake, you should know to calm yourself down, like tread carefully, but he didn't. And the manager as well can see that in the second half, Fred was still making mistakes and tackling people and stabbing people. That moment there, take him off, bring on Van de Beek. One thing that annoyed me in that game is that it's the amount of time we just can't keep the ball. We can't keep the ball against good teams.
Bruno couldn't do it all by himself.
Can I say something? It's not about personnel. It's to keep the ball. It's about what happens in training.
No, that's true.
How do we train to keep the ball?
I understand what you're saying.
Man United, no, we don't keep the ball. Ole Gunnar Solskjaer, we don't keep the ball. Under Mourinho for the last 2, 3, 4 seasons, have been unable to make 5 successive passes and keep the ball
for even a minute or two
coming off the pitch. Like, this is back to training basis. Like,
definitely true.
How do you keep the ball? We work on it. We work on how we keep possession. But against big teams, we can't keep the ball for a minute.
Because you need the quality as the training. It's both.
Quality. We got enough quality.
I believe we have the quality.
We got enough quality to keep the ball.
To keep the ball, Scott and Fred?
No. Keep the ball.
But a system in place that keeps the ball. Yes. Then Scott and Fred will know their roles. They'll keep them because they're practiced on keeping the ball. They're not practicing on keeping the ball.
You see players, for example, yeah?
Wolves. Can keep the ball.
Liverpool can
keep the ball. Sure. Is Henderson the best in possession?
Yes,
but he can keep the ball. Because why? There's a system there that allows them to keep the ball. You know, they train to keep the ball.
No, spot on. You got this spot on.
They train to keep the ball. They put themselves in triangles. Like, a coach does everything to ensure that you, when he has the ball, you're in that position. And when he has the ball, you're in that position. You make yourself available in every situation. And we drill it. Imagine that I train with bin cones. Their training is bins, cones, and trash cans, and everything, and going around it. What the hell is that? Have you ever seen any of their videos? I've seen their videos of training. They're just kicking the ball in bins. Now, what is that? And they're kicking balls in bins, and then we on a training pitch, we can't even put the ball in the back of the net. And the bin is smaller, and the net is bigger.
True.
I don't get it. I just don't get it. Again, coaching, manager. Players, I can't blame the players because you can only go out and do what your manager tells you to do. Just like an employee, I can only do what my manager tells me to do.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way my manager has trained me. But that coaching team, that management team has never been good enough, because there's certain things that I see in every game. Unable to keep the ball. Unable to tell Marcus Rashford, you should be there when we have the ball. Unable to tell Anthony Martial, you should be there when you have the ball. The fact that Bruno told his own manager, you need to make a sub, says it all about our manager. Our players don't rate him. He's not good enough. I don't rate him. My unborn child don't rate him. A lot of people don't rate him. Like, I'm tired of him. I'm fully tired of him. Yeah. That loss, yeah. Well, don't worry. We're in a good place. It's not the end of the world.
But we're not in a good place.
No, but it's not the end of the world.
No, it's not the end of the world, but we are not in a good place because we might lose that match and not qualify.
Do you think what do you think? Do you think we can beat Leipzig away?
We've been away from... But because it's Manchester United we're talking about. It's all his team we're talking about.
But you know, for the big games, mm-hmm. remember the first leg against PSG in France? Yeah. We won.
Yeah, and they lost again. They lost against us already at Old Trafford. They learned the lesson. This is a club that's never conceded 5 goals in a match in the European competition. Do you think that's going to happen? I don't know if you lot see where I'm coming from. I'm not trying to be negative. I'm just going to give you lot the reality. In case we lose this match, We're not going Champions. We're not qualifying.
We're going Europa League.
You get what I mean? So what we're saying is this: that game now got upset. If you go back to the few two videos from this, you can see my obsession. We now got upset against the Turkish team. Was it
Istanbul?
We should have won that match.
See, now that match means
a lot
right now to us.
You get what I mean? So at the end of the day, I know we keep saying we're trying to be optimistic, be positive, which is good. But let's just be realistic. What if we lose that match? What happens to Manchester United? Because that's the last match. What happens to United?
I kind of believe we can still beat RB Leipzig, because I know when Ollie's job's on the line, he turns into prime Barcelona 2011 and Pep Guardiola, prime Pep Guardiola. That's what he turns into. That Manchester United team turns into Barcelona of the class of 2011 that beat us in the Champions League final. That's what happens in Wembley. That's what happens every time Ollie's job's on the line. That man them transform.
I don't think Ollie's job is on the line after that.
No, but if it was on the line, let's say for example, we lose to West Ham this weekend. His job's on the line again. His job will be on the line.
I don't think so.
Ollie's always like one result away from getting sacked all the time. Like,
yeah, no, he needs like 4 or 5 L's in a row before that can happen.
Well, I know that I would have sacked him a long time.
Now, hopefully, anyway. We do win that match. But I'm just saying, what if we don't win that match? What happens to Manchester United? We're going to play Europa. And what happens to what we've been talking about since this season started, or since last season, about you actually just spoke a lot about it. The management team surrounding Manchester United, the people surrounding Ollie, what are the jobs, what do you really do, the training session, like all this stuff. Hopefully we qualify, but if not, I'm going to have to ask you a whole lot of questions in the videos, the next show's coming up. You have to answer a few questions.
I can't believe we train with trash cans and bins and all that stuff. This is the reason why we have apprenticeship people. That's the type of stuff that you bring up when you're new to the game. You have Matt Carrick, who hasn't had the best experience, new to the game. Kieran McKenna, who was coaching on the 18, new to the game. Mike Feelings, old to the game. Expired, you know? Expired. The guy still wears shorts on the match day, bruv. Like... which coach wears his shorts on match day except for training pitches? Like, you don't do that on match day. Man's shopping in Sports Direct, buying these Sports Direct shorts just to come on match day. I'm tired.
Old school.
But let's talk about Martial. What's going on with him?
I hope the form changes quick though, because it's this for me since he came to United. This one of his worst start. One goal. That's a penalty. Not even. That's something that from was a good gameplay or whatever. So from the penalty.
James, what's going on with him?
He's lacking confidence. I feel like since he got sent off from that Tottenham game, he's come back. I think it was a 3-game ban.
Yeah,
he's come back and he hasn't looked the same. I have faith in him because I know his quality. He's a world class player, but he just needs to build that confidence. I don't know how he's going to do it. I want to see him start more. And let's just keep our fingers crossed. But he is a quality player. He's just lacking a bit of confidence at the moment, you know?
Fair enough. Let's move on straight up to the next game, which is, of course, the wonderful comeback against Southampton, being 2-0 down by halftime. Of course, in my video, if you watch that, guys, if you should go and watch that. At halftime, we all knew that Ollie out was trending, man. We was all like, what the F is this, man? What is this, bro? Like, half-time, 2-0 down. But, you know, kudos to Ollie for bringing on Cavani, making the changes at half-time, taking off Greenwood as well. It was a bit cool. Cavani affecting the game from the moment he came on.
Super sub.
We came back and won the match 3-2. Mm-hmm. Great comeback, but I wasn't happy with the first half. I wasn't happy in general that we had to go through that. Yeah, but at the same time, stuff, matches like that, do really cheer you up as well. Like, you make you think, I love these type of games, but you don't want to go through these things. These emotions are not good. It hurts you.
Heart was beating fast.
Like, if too guys, much. If you have like heart problems, you would have a heart attack. That's what Manchester United do these days. They give us heart attacks. You don't know what we're expecting with Manchester United. We could be playing good. One game, we play good. Next game, we play rubbish. Next game after we play okay. Like, it's a Russian roulette with Manchester United.
It was a good reaction though. From the boys in the second
half.
Exceptional. Cavani, I take my hat off. It was beautiful, Cavani. But at the same time, I feel like that second goal from Prowse, De Gea should have saved that, no? Or is it just
me? Bro, hit the side net, man. That was typical.
It wasn't De Gea's fault.
I feel like De Gea should have saved that, you know?
It was the line. It was the line.
The guy, when you shoot a ball, curl it, the side of the net, he touched it. Is hard. You know by penalties when people go for side nets.
It was a very good free kick. The guy injured himself.
You know he tried his best. He injured himself. It was that peak. The moment I saw De Gea crashing it, that's how you know the precision of Daniel's free kick was too much.
But then it's just reminding me of another situation, maybe just 2 weeks ago. There was yet another free kick where De Gea ran into the post, or he got the ball from behind the line.
Yeah.
De Gea, fix up, man.
But he's improved the season, though.
Yeah, he has.
Since Henderson's come back.
Yeah. He needs that competition.
He made some wonderful saves yesterday.
Yesterday.
The ball went past him. I don't know how he just dipped and grabbed the ball back. How was that? I thought it was a goal, though. But when I saw that, well, guess what? The ball went corner, in Fiji eventually scored the second goal because of defensive error.
As you were saying, Jerks, you didn't even finish by the match.
Yeah, it was a good game. Cavani, super sub, one assist, two goals. He's just showing what he can do at the moment, you know? It's good to have that sort of centre forward in the team. You guys know I was a bit sceptical when he first came in. I don't like to bring in those older players.
We all was.
But he's proven his worth. Let's just see what he can do for this season, you know? But it was a very good game, especially in the second half as we came back. Southampton have had a great season. They were sitting maybe fourth or fifth.
Before we played them.
Yeah. So it shows that it wasn't going to be an easy game. St. Mary's has never...
It's never been easy for us. Not just the team itself.
Exactly. So I can't complain. When it comes to the Premier League nowadays, I just want 3 points.
Trust.
We play rubbish and get 3 points, I'm happy. I don't know about you guys.
I'm so disgusted on the board. I'm disgusted on the board because What are they wearing in terms of glasses? What do they smoke? What do they drink when they watch Manchester United?
I think they're probably talking about business and sipping on wine.
Most likely, smoking
cigars and stuff.
Because I'm disgusted, like, as a board owner, to see that on Saturday, you need to start questioning the guy that makes all the... Even the game against against PSG. The game against, which one was before Southampton?
That was the
West Brom.
West Brom.
All these games... It's just signs that this guy is not good enough. And the board themselves, they're all incompetent people. Because we can clearly see that this doesn't work and this shouldn't be Manchester United. We shouldn't be struggling in games. I know when I was watching Ferguson's team, we didn't struggle like this.
No, we did not.
I knew the first 10 minutes that those teams would go at us for the first 10 minutes. But as soon as the match starts settling...
Domination.
All over them.
If you came down to Fergie time, we would be all over them until the 94th minute.
Total domination.
We missed that. But then we can't live in the past, can we?
Yeah, we cannot live in the past. We have to live in the present. That's always...
Yeah, but how are you going to live in the present if you don't modify or update yourself or upgrade yourself?
By knowing your history. That's a good point.
So, like, we all talk about living in the modern generation, right? TVs get updated every 6 months. Mobile phone get updates every month. When did Manchester United upgrade?
I don't know. We're still in that same version.
Still in that same version. Like,
Ferguson retired.
You know what I mean? So, 2.0. Man City 2.0. Done the upgrade. Liverpool done the upgrade. Chelsea going through the upgrade. So, I don't know.
All the clubs have upgraded. They modernized themselves. They modernized the structure of the club. Whereas we are just still in the 90s.
They don't even have a football, what's it called?
Director of football, a technical director, whatever you want to call that, you know, sporting director. All those modern terms for someone that's involved in the football.
It's funny, like, but all we can just complain and hope hopefully things change. Like, for those who make decisions at the top there. But like, we were talking about Cavani. You know, I've always been optimistic about Cavani. Like, I was happy. For me, it's like when you got Christmas coming, they give you a Christmas present, and your mom calls you in the room and give you a little present, say, don't let your sister or brother see this year. For me, that's Cavani for us. You get what I mean? Like, we've all seen what he does. Like, I wasn't scared. I was really, really excited. The only downside of it was, why are we getting these players when they're over 30? Why are we getting these players over 30? But at the end of the day, we just seen what he can do. Now, I have to believe, we signing Cavani was one of the best deals we've done this summer.
Short term, definitely.
Not that this summer, that's the best deal. So it was a good signing, and obviously I can't emphasize on his quality. Now we all know what he does.
World class.
He definitely was my man to match that in that game.
And one thing I could say, I don't want us to get excited over that match too much, you know, because we came from 2 goals behind. But me, as a Manchester United fan, as a spectator, I felt like it was a layoff because of qualities we got in the team. It wasn't Oli. It just made, like I said, Oli got this thing about him that makes him different. Just one little thing might change Oli's perception. Like you said, either he's going to get sacked or either we're going to cuss him. Like you said, Oli out was trending. Just that little substitution he made. I feel like Cavani should just tired that much.
Yeah.
As much as I love Greenwood, should have been on the bench or coming after, or even bench the whole match. And I want to ask you something. Why didn't we have, even if for 5 minutes, why have you not seen N'Golo?
We saw him a couple of minutes when was yesterday.
That's basking this.
You see, the thing is, why we haven't seen him? Because Ollie doesn't know what his best 11 is. He doesn't know who to start, who to play. Like,
why have we got him giving him free money?
He's down the pecking order now since Cavani's come in. He's like,
now, how are we getting him
You mentioned Greenwood, yeah? He started against, but what happened to him yesterday then? Why did you do this yourself? You started players that were not ready to start, and then you opted them out in the next game. Like, this is what I mean about Wally gonna show show, because he's a Wally, bro. No, I don't kind of call him Wally. Wally, yeah, he's a Wally.
The robotic movie back in the day.
He's an idiot. Because you just start players who are not fit. Yeah, just so you can get your best 11 and then ignore the players that who are fit or are on form, and then the next game you take them out, you bring this guy in. Like McTominay, who's been out for how many months? Weeks, yeah. Why is he starting? When you have PSG and you have Van de Beek, we're ready to start.
It's not a problem.
Let me just give you this.
It's not a problem. Because Scott,
we're at home.
PSG, yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
But Scott has always played well against PSG.
Yeah. But guess what?
Always.
Eventually, you have that odd game that you're not playing well.
Exactly. But then it comes down to the fact that at home, we don't need both of them. It could have been Fred or Scott.
Wanted Van de Beek to be with Fred. Why? To make things simple, keep the ball, make the right passes. And what's it called? We could not break the line of PSG from midfield. All of this, McTominay and Fred, side to side. Fred tried to pass the ball forward a couple of times. He's the only one out of those two that will try and break the lines. McTominay is just straight side to side.
He couldn't even hold Neymar. Neymar's all of him yesterday. And I got upset in the first half. I literally got upset. See, there was this time that Neymar was actually moving to him. And he came and covered him up and he went behind. He caught. And I was thinking, why are you there then? Why you need some defender to come help you out? But like I said, all these tactics, man management and team management are poor. These are things that I've never seen from Oli. That's why I've never been a fan of Oli. Yesterday just proved me right. And people might get excited over the Southampton match and the other games that we won. Fair enough. But did we see anything different than what we've seen for the past year and a half from Oli? Counter-attacking football, score a few goals, and get the whole team excited.
Why are we a counter-attacking team? Since when has Manchester United been a counter-attacking team worrying about the opposition?
But I did say
how they set up.
Since Jose.
I did say that though.
What is this?
No, I did say that since when Oli came.
What is
I said
this?
Oli got that from Jose.
What is
Oli
this?
Oli actually got that from Jose.
Mm-hmm. Why are we... You see, guys, you need to open your mind and open your eyes and open those ears. Get cobwebs or whatever, cotton buds, clean those ears. And what's it called? If you want to go to the optician and get your eyes checked. Because why are we playing counter-attacking football? When does a top club, yeah, that's known to be an attacking club, yeah, play a counter-attacking football? Clubs that are below 10th in their league play counter-attacking football. They don't go out there and play attacking.
Wolves don't
We're
play
We're a big club.
Wolves
We're
don't
a
play.
Top club. Top players that was earning big bucks. We should be having managers
who play attacking football and progressive, aggressive, not pragmatic, yeah, football. Progressive and attacking, you know?
Definitely.
Football, aggressive.
Aggressive.
None of that, none of that pragmatic, slow crap that we've been playing. Don't know what to do when we have the ball. You see with Maguire and Lindelof, to me.
No,
we don't know what to do. Like, most of the time we have the ball, it's in defence. It's not in that middle of midfield. It's with between Lindelof and Maguire. And then Fred tries to get in there. But no real midfielder is dropping deep to get the ball to carry it, to spray it forward.
We need that deep line in midfielder.
Yeah,
we
do.
We do have players.
We do actually have a deep line.
We do have players. We do have players.
Bruno wasn't getting the ball yesterday. Anyway, because of that.
Let's not dwell on it. Well, we've gone too far into this, guys. Guys, do let us know what you thought of those two matches against PSG and also against Sunderland. We move up straight. We want to kind of keep it as brief as possible. Move straight to the incident, that controversial post made by Edison Cavani regarding the word Negro and thank you Negro or Negrito, which he was saying thank you to a friend of his who is happened to be black, mm-hmm. Yeah, and etc. Of course, it got picked up by the media and it got picked up by the FA board. Now it's looking to be investigated in the sense of racism.
Mm-hmm.
For my opinion, of course, I'm not going to defend the word Negro or Negrito because at the end of the day, you can't change someone's language that's been there for thousands of years, mm-hmm. Yeah? That's not going to change. But they should change the word black because it shouldn't be that word. But he was saying that he was acknowledging a friend, saying thank you. That was a salute to his friend. Yeah, but his friend hasn't come out and said that. He is. Mm-hmm. But to say that it was a racist post, that's the controversial bit. I'm a black man. But as some things I can see as racism, some things I can see, no, he's not racist.
Mm-hmm.
But those who make the decision of what is racist, they're the people that are not of our colour.
Mm-hmm.
So they can't come out and say he made a racist post. Only we can say that, and people of other ethnic minority, such as the Asians, the Latinos, can say, no, that's a racist post. But if a white man comes and says that's a racist post, I look at you saying, do you know what really racism is? Because you don't know what racism is, you know? You know? You don't know what racism is. I know what racism is because we live it day in, day out, year in, year out. Like it's nothing. Like, from the moment we're born, we know what racism is. As soon as we come out of our mother's stomach, the white nurse is looking at us.
Yeah.
You know? As soon as we already experience racism. All right. Well, my personal opinion is that I don't think Edison Cavani was being racist. I don't believe he's racist at all, you know. I don't think he's racist. It just came out wrong. It came out wrong. When you speak a different language, it comes out wrong.
I think it came across as a term of endearment to his friend. It was a similar word that Suarez said to Evra.
By the way, I was only joking about the nurse thing, by the way. I'm only joking.
It was a similar word to what Suarez said to Evra all those years back, if you guys remember.
Yes.
Yeah.
But remember, Suarez kept on saying it with intent. Continuously.
Exactly. That's the difference. He refused to shake hands mm-hmm. with Evra.
But mm-hmm. listen to this.
Mm-hmm.
This time last year, Bernardo Silva, if you remember,
was
banned for one game
mm-hmm.
for tweeting something or comparing Mendy to a black character.
Yeah.
I feel, as much as I don't think Cavani was racist in what he said, like you said, mm-hmm. you can't really change people's language, isn't it?
True.
But the FA needs to be consistent.
True.
The FA needs to ban Cavani for one game then. If we are going to take this stuff seriously, there needs to be consistency. True. There needs to be some sort of framework in place whereby it's an easy job. He said this, boom, that's immediately three weeks off. 500k fine. It needs to be consistent. So FA, Cavani, I want you to continue playing for us, but you might have to sit out for a day or two.
Do we really need that right now?
We don't need that. But you know what it is? We also need to be educated.
Yeah, yes, of course.
No, when people come into the Premier League,
that's true.
They should go on a one-day course.
No, one week.
Induction course.
Just literally took it out of my mouth.
Induction course.
That's what Gary Neville mentioned on Sky Sports.
Oh, for real?
Say the FA, they got up to 4 to 5 bodies that just concentrate on racism within the football.
Mm-hmm.
Within football, they up to 5 bodies. Black Lives Matter just been included.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you lot don't know this, Black Lives Matter is included in FIFA. So at the end of the day, what Gary Neville said, I totally agree with it. Like, if you, a foreign player, coming to a country, there should be a strategy put in place for this place. Like, not telling you you got how to use social media, mm-hmm. but it's just certain conversation that you might not. We might not want you to partake in, because it might bring clashes between either racial or the or whatever is going on in this world. As in this 2020, one thing I found in 2020 is cancel culture. The only people that don't get cancelled is footballers.
But you never gave us your opinion on his comment.
I don't think it's a racial comment, like, because obviously you say it's a how do you call it, language that's been there for centuries, mm-hmm. and. But the only thing I can emphasize on myself on right now is with what Jake said. We got to be real with yourself. If he did say something or tweet something that kind of racial and been flagged as racial, he needs to get the punishment that everyone's been getting it.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely Cavani needs to get it. At mm-hmm. least one or two game off, we'll take it. But that would teach these players, these foreign players that come into this country, yeah. to say certain words that you say in your language might not be right to say,
yeah.
in, mm-hmm. but like, definitely agree with you. Like you said, consistency, everything needs to be consistent with what they do.
Fair enough, guys. Guys, you let us know what you thought of that controversial post by Edinson Cavani. We move right straight to that weekend, of course. Yeah. Lovely weekend if you're us. If you're an Arsenal fan, it wasn't a lovely weekend. If you're a Liverpool fan, it wasn't the best weekend of you for you. If you're a Man City fan, it probably wasn't a good time. Chelsea, Tottenham.
Yeah.
If you're a Tottenham fan, you're still on top of the table. You must have enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm.
Chelsea fan, you should be pissed off, because mm-hmm. I thought you lost 1-1.
Yeah. Whereas, of course, let's go straight into that weekend. Wrap up. Highlight of the week.
This is the first time I'm going to say this. United.
That
was my match of the week.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the first time I want to say a United game was the best game of the weekend. Great second half. If I was to choose a team away from Manchester, Wolves versus Arsenal.
Trust me.
Arteta, what are you saying? Gunners, saying?
It's Mikel Pulis. Because he plays defensive football. Mikel Pulis.
Guess what Tripp said? Guess what Tripp said? He said, bro, Rice Clack, man. Man, been living in America for almost a month, yeah? And I haven't even got a win yet from Arsenal, man. But I was busting up. Hey, big up to Tripp, though.
My match was definitely tough, and was the Wolves game against Arsenal, man. Mikel Pulis, bro, you need to sort yourself out, bro. All this defensive football, playing two defense. Do you remind me of us playing holding midfielders? Yeah. Two holding midfielders. No real playmakers at all.
They need Ozil back, you know.
No, yeah, they need Ozil back. But of course, it's a political issue with Ozil, of course, with the whole situation, with what he said about China, how the way they treat Muslim players. Even though I agree with him.
I agree with him to a small extent.
No, I agree with him to a great extent. Like, it's about humanitarian rights at the end of the day. I respect Ozil. But I don't respect Arsenal because I know the reason why they're backing, because it affects their money and sponsorship mm-hmm. money. And all they care about is money, you see?
But guess what? I didn't cut that off from you, though.
Mm-hmm.
When it's time to do the parade thing, Arsenal back it up, though.
Yeah.
When it's come to do with religion, someone that's trying to stand up for religion, they're not backing
it up. They're not backing up.
But they can put the rainbows or laces on and all that captain handband. Yep. When it's time they go do religion, they can't back it up, and that's just, for me, sad and pathetic.
It's very sad.
It's sad.
Especially when you deep what's happening in China.
Yeah.
These Muslim...
and the fact that even the whole black people that were in China being mistreated during that COVID, blaming it on
us,
like, we carried that virus out. No.
We don't invent nothing.
Mm-hmm.
We class as one of the poorest nation in the world, right? Technology, we backwards. Everything that the Western world is 10 times better than, if you put in percentage, they could be 10 out of 10, and we could be 4 out of 10. So when do we have to start building all these viruses? I'm from a country that's called Sierra Leone, West Africa. 2 years ago, we had Ebola.
Mm-hmm.
We know what it did to us. Mm-hmm. So at the end of the day, there's so much we can say, but then let's just keep it humble and keep it real. Like we said, with the effort, keep be consistent, I think everything, every team, everything in every entertainment industry, in the surrounding industry, should be consistent with the decision making based on either religion, like sexuality, wherever they go, wherever they're trying to include into the game that we love. They gotta be consistent with it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I gotta say about that particular topic, consistency with everything that the FA, whoever's concerned with football, the entertainment industry in general, gotta be consistent with the lawmaking.
Cool. We wanna wrap it up with the preview against West Ham. Of course, we've gone over a bit of time. Straight away, Jags, what do you think against West Ham? We're playing that away.
At their gaff.
We can't where we've struggled last season as well.
We cannot lose to Moyes. I don't want to hear that we're going to lose to Moyes. That will break my heart. I'm going for the win. Albeit, West Ham have had a great start to the season. They're fifth, you know?
Another game, we'll play someone that's fifth again.
West Ham are fifth in the table. So
we might win.
We need to come with something.
We need to come with something.
And by something, I mean not two holding midfielders. I don't care where away from home. I want to see Van der Beek.
Yes, so you're going for that win, yeah?
W.
I'm going to go for that win, yeah? Hopefully, innit? Oli, don't let man down, you know? Because if you let man down with the team selection and everything, the way the team plays, because the team can't play football... I don't even know what I want to do.
I'm going for the win, yeah, but I just gotta say this, obviously I want us to win, but all this move like a married man who cheats, isn't it? When you go wife at home, you're keeping it safe, but when you go away there to the side thing, you got your hand from.
Yeah, I don't get it.
Fool me. So
I don't get it.
You better go home, you know.
Man, what a you better go team. Home
from.
You are the main thing. You need to go ham on us, you know? You get me?
Always grab ham away from home.
Always. You know we got sighting, bub. You know, then and then. Yeah, yeah. Just go ham.
Go ham on the sighting.
On the wife, yeah, you got to be careful.
Yeah.
You're at home. You're home.
But away, you want to impress that woman, bro.
You want to impress that.
Yo, Oli, you can't be doing that to us, you know. But yeah, straight, guys. Straight, 3 wins from us, of course. We hope we win. Yeah, hope we get that W, you know, so we can rise above that table again and again and make things look good for us, especially because we've got a game in hand. So we have to stay with winning until we got that game in hand and capitalize on it.
It would be nice if we finish in the top five within Christmas, because I haven't really seen us sit around that fifth position. We've been Christmas for a few years now.
After the start we had.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, so it would be nice,
though.
It would be nice to be in the top five, for real.
Yes. Let us know exactly what you thought of everything, whether we're going to win the match against West Ham. Of course, your opinion on Cavani, your opinion on the match, the two matches. We have come to the end of the show, guys. We'd like to thank you for watching, as always, of course. And today, of course, I'm Nook. Where can the man, them, and the girl, them find you?
Always on Instagram, PreyFlacco_16. Banner.
And Jags, where can the man, them, girl, them find you?
Simply Jags_United. Insta.
Instagram. Guys, if you're looking for me, of course, you can find me on the Instagram. @Ivorian_Spice. And also follow me on my Twitter and also on Snapchat. It's the same thing. And do remember to follow the official Red United Instagram account, which is Red United TV1. And also remember to subscribe, smash that like button, remember to share to everyone that you don't like and you do like. Also, share to Oli, because he needs to see this. He really needs to see this. Share it to Oli, share it to McFeelan, McKenna. If you know Ed, I know he's got probably like a burner account somewhere. Send it to him as well. And Mike Feelan as well, please leave. But yeah, guys, it's been wonderful as always. Remember to keep it united. And remember to keep it Red United. We out, guys. Peace.